Good evening, everyone. I'm Yan Zhong. Today, my presentation topic is the crude oil pricing prediction with machine learning techniques. So, as we all know, crude oil is very important for the development of a country and is very important factors in manufacturing. Another thing with the beauty of predictions, you cannot know what happens in the future, but you only know what happens in the past. So, by doing the right action, you can actually have the chance to make money or arbitrage. And also with the development of the big data, I'm going to use some more modernized techniques to do the prediction. So as for the crude oil price prediction, this is a very heated topic that has already had many scholars having discussion on that. So the first data set I'm going to use is I will borrow the influential factors in crude oil price forecasting from the knowledge oil paper. It includes the data from January 4th, 2002 to September 25th, 2015 on a weekly basis. And the response variable will be the West Texas Intermediate crude oil spot price, and there will be 19 potential controls. Here's the summary data, and obviously not all of them are statistically significant. So this is obviously a time series data, so I'll generate a lag with time period t minus 1. And also, I'm going to discuss also two things. The return will be the WTI price minus the lag, and or the WAG price. This not only measures the magnitude of the price change, but also gives us the sign. And also, I generated a dummy variable. If the compared to the last time period, if the price is negative, the dummy variable ink will be 1, else the ink will be 0. So I run a regression on that. And as we can see, some statistically significant. The first one, the global crude oil production and export, this kind of makes sense. And the third one is the Baltic Exchange Dirty Tanker Index. This is the numbers of the track that will send out the crude oil. And it's obviously, if the more tracks are running, there is more oil is trading. And the fourth one is the ISM index. It's a manufacturing index based on the survey of 300 manufacturing companies, and the high grades indicate the prosperity of manufacturing industry. And the fifth one is the MSCI index. This is a part of the SP 500, and this measures the financial market. And finally, it's trading ratio. This is the ratio of the crude oil future contracts over the total number of production. And this is measures the speculative factors. And so based on the simple linear regression on the full model, we only found out 6 of them are statistically significant. So I ran another regression with by taking out only the variable that I think is significant. And here's the result. And it saved all the predicted values. And before we doing further analysis, I'm going to do the box plot transformation in SAS, and this is the power of lambda they suggested. And here's the regression on the transform model. And here are some of the comparisons. This is the full model, and the blue line is the value of the WTI, and the red line is the predicted value. Obviously, it's not doing so good. Captures the general trend, but not very accurate. And this is a comparison of return. It's also kind of like capture the trend, but not so accurate. And how about the dummy variable of increase? Well, since this is a binary variable, it's only between, it's either 0 or 1. So the predicted value is approximate to the probability. So it's like somewhere between 0 and 1. And the full model is kind of have more variations, and the reduced model are more centered from like 0.3 to 0.7. here we're going to introduce some arbitrage opportunities. So as we can see from this graph, there's like the probability from 0.2 to like 0.9, and which one, from which point we should to do the trade, and from which point we can make the most of money. And this is what we're going to investigate in the following parts. So if the ink is 1, and we'll first set up a benchmark P0. So if the predicted value is greater than the benchmark we set, we'll assume we'll predict the price will increase, and we'll like do the trade and to make money. And if the predicted value is greater than the benchmark and it's actually increases, this will be a correct prediction. And if it's, we predict it increased but it's actually do not increase, this is a type 2 error. And similarly, when it's actually increases but we didn't capture it, it's a type 1 error. And if it's actually did not increase it and it's actually did not increase, then this is also a correct capture. And next, we're going to use the Bayes' theorem for the binary variable. And we denote the event A as it's actually increases, and event B as we predict it will increase. So the conditional probability on the whether we are doing the correct predictions here. So the probability of A, which is the probability that will actually increase, is there's 319 cases over 682 cases. It's a fixed number of 0.47, and when the ink is 0, is just 1 minus this number, which is 0.53. And the probability of B given A is, because these two things are independent, so they're just a union of them. And the probability of B is definitely dependent on the benchmark we're setting. And actually, I tried all the numbers from 0.21 to 0.9. So I use Python to draw this graph and to make the loop. And here we can find out this is the prediction of full model. Like the maximum probability of the probability of B given A is just we predict the price will increase, and it actually increases. So at the maximum, we can have 80% chance to do the right action with the full model. And with the reduced model, we can have at most 60% chance to do the correct action. And for the transform model, we can have like 59% chance to do the right action. And here's the and here is the benchmark we're going to set. And also we can calculate at which point we can make the most money. So for the correct action, if we predict the price will be going up and it's actually going up, and we do the trade, so this will denote as a profit that we will be going to earn. And if the price we predict is going to goes up, but it's actually not, this means we didn't have to error. That's and at this point we do the trade, it will be a loss. And when the price is going up, but we didn't capture it, this will be an unearned profit. And when it's actually going down, and we predict it going down, this will be the avoided loss. Sorry, this should be a loss. And the difference between the absolute value of these two numbers will be the net gain. The difference between absolute value of these two numbers will be the net loss. And here we'll calculate the net gain and the loss again. So the blue lines are the net gain, and the yellow lines are the net loss. So for the full model here, at most we can make 3.63. Dollar on each unit we trade by setting up the benchmark at 0.79, and we can avoid the loss of 1.4.
So you have different benchmarks for buying and selling?
Yes.
Okay. So there's an interval where you do neither. It's not high enough that you think it's going to increase, and it's not low enough that you're going to bet it decreases. So you do you don't do anything.
I haven't checked that yet, but okay. I will add an amount later. Yes.
Because the cutoff points have to do with the predicted value, right?
Yeah, because this is only the optimal value, but I didn't add some point that's. I think anywhere for the gain, I think anywhere that you'll have a negative point for the gain will be the point that we shouldn't trade.
Right.
Not high enough. And similar here, if this
right.
Going to the positive, that should be the point that we shouldn't do.
Okay.
I guess so. I will check later.
Okay.
So this is the data set I brought from other people, and they only cover data from 2002 to 2015, and I updated data with the newly data on daily basis from October 2015 to February 2028, and I only picked up the six factor that are statistically significant because it's not necessary to check all the 19 variables. But one thing that needs to be mentioned is I didn't find the data for the trading ratio, so I found the total monthly trading volume to replace that one. And also the time. Since the new data set is on a daily basis, so we can assume on a particular trading date, you observe the data from the last trading date, and you decide whether you're going to do on the next trading date. So we're going to set the time like as two time period. And here are the summary statistics. It's the single linear regression again here. But now we only find only the production and experts are statistically significant, and all other variables and amounts statistically significant. And here's the box transformation again, it says. And here's the result. It suggests only production and experts are statistically significant. And here's a comparison of the picture. Also, the red line is the predicted value, and the blue line is the actual value. It's captured the most of the trend, but not so the return is there. And here is also calculated the open trading point. So in this case, there's only 217 cases that the price is actually is increasing. So now the PA is going down to 0.046, and here and the not is 0.54. And the opening point here is at most we can do like 0.63, and here's 0.61. It's not as good as that in the original model because I guess there's so much variation in the nowadays data, and the opening point error like 5.9. And here's the gain and loss again. Again, there's so much variation and it's a little messy. And I think maybe I should take the advice of finding some point that we shouldn't trade on the danger. Okay. So related to machine learning, there are four types of learning types, the supervised learning, unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning, and reinforcement learning. So for each type, in this study, we used the simple linear regression, which is a kind of a supervised learning, because we set up certain criteria and we can predict with our work to do. And simple linear regression is always a nice way to start any prediction. And now we are going to use the decision tree, which will I will do this in R Studio with the partition package. This is a classification method, which is also supervised learning. And each internal node will be more clean than the original model. This is the transformed model. But actually, I personally think the original model makes more sense, because the transformed model, you can see here is the 4.22 to the 14th power. It's like a trillion level number. It's too big. It doesn't make so much sense. The last one there, I'm going to try is the recurrent neural network and the long short-term memory. This is a little bit complex. So first we're going to include some the input layer, and we are going to find out the relation in the hidden layer, and we are going to find out the output. And for each input we put in, and we will find out the relation between the last time period, and we decide whether we will pass this feature to the next time period. So in this study, because the newly updated data set only have 586 observations, so I used the entire data set to as our the time we're training, and the time set is 10. And the learning rates will decide the rates of the algorithms will be converged, and we will divide the training to the testing the set of training set and testing set to 2 over 1, because we can only observe data from the past and to decide where to have in the future.
And one thing is, we're not doing so good, because
I think there's some problems when I set up the parameters, but I didn't get so much time to find out the optimal level. It shouldn't be not so bad. Okay, so some conclusion. Well, I tried a lot of ways to do the accurate comparison, but the reality is much more harder and much more complex than people that would expect. I think I remember from my econometric course, math is the best language for analysis, and statistically numbers will never lie to you, but economics will tell you what actually makes sense. Everybody can make like some really fancy tools, but not everyone will know what actually makes sense.
Well, I do have some questions.
Yes.
At the very beginning, you have the simple linear regression model. Do you think the very beginning?
This one?
Yeah. So do you think the production of crude oil will influence those indexes?
You mean?
Like the first one, the production will influence the ISM and MSCI index. Did you check the plot? Did you check the multicollinearity?
Oh, I didn't. I should do that. Well, but to be honest, these are like different factors, because this is a manufacturing index, and this is measures what happens in the financial market. So they maybe have some relationship, but I'm not sure. I can go back and check. That's a good point. Thank you.
Yeah. And the second question is, what is your goal of constructing the decision tree and the neuroclassic model?
Obviously, is to find the optimal level to find a as precise as possible prediction, because this will lead us to make more accurate decision and to make money potentially.
You mean the prediction of about
yes.
The oil price, right?
Yes.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
You had an out sample example. You know, that's daily, right?
Yes.
Are you basing it on your predictions that way?
It's also daily.
Daily. Okay. So you redid it.
Yes.
Okay. So what did you do? You left, say, 100 periods out when you estimated the model,
mm-hmm.
or whatever number it is. Okay. Any questions?
I'm just curious, what got you interested in this?
Mm-hmm.
Or like, how did you, I'm just curious.
Well, to be honest, because I'm applying graduate school in financial engineering, so
okay.
I'm going to try something like this.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, began as a financial engineering.
Well, if this is like another reason for teaching financial mathematics, maybe they will just to suggest some optimal like training algorithms, but that's not what I can do right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's too hard for me. That's the best I can see of it.
Yes.
This
part basically in naturally because